Hello all, welcome to this video on operating systems. The topics we'll be looking into today are deadlocks and starvation in semaphores, priority inversion and bounded buffer problem, which is one of the classical problems of synchronization. Let's begin. The implementation of a semaphore with a waiting queue may result in a situation where two or more processes are waiting indefinitely for an event that can be caused only by one of the waiting processes. The event in question is the execution of a signal operation. When such a state is reached, these processes are said to be deadlocked. To illustrate this, consider a system consisting of two processes P0 and P1, each accessing two semaphores S and Q, set to the value 1. Suppose that P0 execute wait of S and then P1 execute wait of Q. When P0 execute wait of Q, it must wait until P1 execute signal of Q. Similarly, when P1 execute wait of S, it must wait until P0 execute signal of S. Since these signal operations cannot be executed, P0 and P1 are deadlocked. We can say that a set of processes is in a deadlocked state when every process in the set is waiting for an event that can be caused only by another process in the set. Another problem related to deadlocks is indefinite blocking or starvation, a situation in which processes wait indefinitely within the semaphore. Indefinite blocking may occur if we remove processes from the list associated with the semaphore in LIFO order, that is last in, first out order. Now let's look into priority inversion. A scheduling challenge arises when a high priority process needs to read or modify the kernel that is being currently accessed by a lower priority process or a chain of lower priority processes. Since kernel data are typically protected with a lock, the higher priority process will have to wait for a lower priority one to finish with the resource. The situation becomes more complicated if the lower priority process is preempted in favor of the process with higher priority. As an example, assume we have three processes L, M and H whose priorities follow the order L less than M less than H. Assume that process H requires resource R, which is currently being accessed by process L. Ordinarily, process H would wait for L to finish using the resource R. However, now suppose that process M becomes runnable, thereby preempting process L. Indirectly, a process with a lower priority, process M, has affected how long process H must wait for L to relinquish the resource R. This problem is known as priority inversion. It occurs only in systems with more than two priorities. So one solution is to have only two priorities. That is insufficient for most general purpose operating systems, however. Typically, these systems solve the problem of priority inheritance using a priority inheritance protocol. According to this protocol, all processes that are accessing resources needed by a higher priority process inherit the higher priority until they are finished with the resource in question. When they are finished, their priorities revert to their original values. In the example above, a priority inheritance protocol would allow process L to temporarily inherit the priority of a process H, thereby preventing process M from preempting their execution. When process L has finished using resource R, it would relinquish its inherited priority from H and assume its original priority. Because resource R would now be available, process H and not M would run next. Now, let's see priority inversion and the Mars Pathfinder. Priority inversion can be more than a scheduling inconvenience. On systems with tight time constraints, such as the real-time systems, Priority inversion can cause a process to take longer than it should to accomplish a task. When that happens, other failures can cascade, resulting in system failure. Consider the Mars Pathfinder, a NASA space probe that landed a robot, the Sojourner rover, on Mars in 1997 to conduct experiments. Shortly after the Sojourner began operating, it started to experience frequent computer resets. Each reset reinitialized all hardware and software, including communications. If the problem had not been solved, the Sojourner would have failed in its mission. The problem was caused by the fact that one high priority process, BC_DIST, was taking longer than expected to complete its work. This task was being forced to wait for a shared resource that was held by a lower priority ASI/MET task, which in turn was preempted by multiple medium priority tasks. The BC_DIST task would stall waiting for the shared resource, and ultimately the BC_shared task would discover the problem and perform a reset. The Sojourner was suffering from a typical case of priority inversion. The operating system on the Sojourner was the VxWorks real-time operating system, which had a global variable to enable priority inheritance on all semaphores. After testing, the variable was set on the Sojourner on Mars and the problem was solved. Now let's look on the bounded buffer problem, which is a classical problem of synchronization. Here the producer and the consumer share the following data structures. We assume that we have a pool which consists of n buffers, each capable of holding one item, and the mutex semaphore provides mutual exclusion for access to the buffer pool and is initialized to the value 1. The empty and full semaphores count the number of empty and full buffers. The semaphore empty is initialized to n and the semaphore full is initialized to 0. This is the code for producer process and this is the code for consumer process. Note the symmetry between the producer and the consumer. We can interpret this code as a producer producing full buffers for the consumer or the consumer producing empty buffers for the producer. So here in producer, what happens is, as we have discussed in some of the previous sessions in a producer-consumer problem, the producer produces an item and place it in the next produced variable, and then it calls the empty semaphore using the wait operation that will decrement the value of n by 1. Then it performs wait operation on the mutex. Now the mutex value will be 0. And then it will add this next produced to the buffer. Then it will call the signal operation on mutex, which will again make its value as 1. And then it will perform signal operation on full. So the value of full will be 1. Whereas in case of a consumer process, first of all, the wait operation is called on the full semaphore. So that value will be decremented by 1. And it will call the wait operation on the mutex. Again, the mutex value is set to 0. And it will remove an item from the buffer and place it in the next consumed variable. Then it calls the signal operation on the mutex. So the mutex value will be again 1. And then it performs the signal operation on empty. So the empty value will be incremented by 1. And then it consumes the item that has been placed in the next consumed. That's all for now. Thank you. Thank you for listening.